can start now.
Good morning, everybody. Church family, it's good to see you all.
Good morning.
See some faces we haven't seen in a while. So happy to, that everybody's here. Today we have the monthly elder meeting that opens, it's open to the public at 6 p.m. And then they close at 7 p.m. tonight. So if you guys want to come talk with the elders, have any ideas about the church, or just want to come and meet them and know them better, come show up at 6 p.m. Then Thursday night, we have the Thursday night Bible study at 7 p.m. It's also on Facebook Live if you can't be here, but it's always just so nice to be here and be a part of that study. You can ask questions from the bar.
Q&A right after, yeah.
Yeah, and it's a really good way to get some of your study in and become more knowledgeable. Next Sunday is New Member Introduction to the Church. And then Friday, October 9th, it's a men's ministry. It starts at 6:30. They have just a lot of fun and fellowship and friends, so the guys are having a good time, so we invite you to come and be a part of that. There's a good message, and again, that's at 6:30. And that's all the announcements that I have for today. But so I was thinking, I was pondering a little bit about angels, and I was thinking, how do angels say hello to each other? Have y'all ever thought about that question? I know it's probably just me. But it dawned on me, they say, halo, halo, halo.
Red, wait a minute, wait a minute, wait, 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 wait. Make up. We are so happy you were born. Happy birthday, Red. Today,
let's go to this year again.
how we doing today?
Good.
For real? Come on now. Y'all can make more noise than that.
Woo!
It is a beautiful day today, amen.
Woo!
And despite everything they tell us, we are still living in a free country, amen.
Amen.
And we can worship Him this morning in spirit and in truth, amen.
Amen.
So y'all answer with all your heart. Y'all make the tent on the roof here rattle. Y'all happy to be in the house of the Lord this morning? I hope you are. I hope you're expecting a blessing today, because we're going to praise His name. That does mean making a joyful noise to the Lord. So y'all be sure and help us out by stomping those feet and clapping those hands when you can. We're going to start off with a little song about being homesick this morning. Amen.
Thank you.
roses and red. I need my Savior, happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above. My story, this is my song, praising my Savior all day long. This is my story, this is my
shine. Yeah.
God is good all the time. He put a song in his heart and mind. God is good all the time. Through the darkest night, his light will shine. God is good. He's so good all the time. Well, we were sinners, so unworthy, but yet for us he chose to die. He filled us with his Holy Spirit, now we can stand and testify that his love is everything, and this place is they will never fail. God is good all the time. Put a song of praise in his heart of mine. God is good all the time. And through the darkest night, his light will shine. God is good. He's so good all the time. Though I may not understand all the plans you have for me, my life is in your hands. And through the eyes of faith, I can clearly see God is good all the time. And a song of praise in his heart of mine. God is good all the time. Through the darkest night, his light will shine. God is good. He's so good. God is good. He's so good. My God is good. He's so good all the time.
We all hang on to what you got just a second. Brother Bob's got to get the other microphone there together. He's going to be taking prayer requests as usual, so get those together as well. And we'll be dismissing the youth right after prayer today. If this is your first time to be with us, as I always say, you know, we do things differently. Just don't pass an offer plate, but there's a little wooden church house back there by the back door. If the Lord touches you to bless the ministry in that manner, that's where to take care of that. All that being said, Brother Bob, you look like you're ready.
I'm ready. I'm ready. Any prayer requests? Yes, ma'am.
My friend Wilma and JD's having trouble with his blood sugar.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Pray for America more than ever after what's happened this week. The next 2 months are going to be probably the greatest festival
for the country. Yeah, they are. But God is in control.
Amen. Amen.
Anybody else? Ms. Reed?
I had my surgery on my nose and reconstruction on Wednesday. So
you said Wednesday?
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else? Yes, ma'am.
Just continue prayer for me for my side pain. I'm going to see my opinion doctor Thursday.
Okay. Done. Up and running. Anybody else? Nobody else? All right, let's go for the Lord. Father God, we love you so very much. Father God, I think what's on most everybody's mind right now is what's going on in our country. Father God, we just put that in your more than capable hands. Father, I know that you're allowing this for a reason, some reason. And Father God, we just need to look for that. Father God, just remember that we serve you. And that's what we're here for. Father God, made us that we just shine a light in the midst of all this darkness that seems to be about. Father God, for that we know for sure that we can do, and we know that that's in your will. So Father God, maybe we just need to be busy about doing what we know to do. Father God, we just ask that you bless our country, this great country, like you once did when you first created and built this country from scratch, Father God. Lord, I believe that you're that first stripe, the red stripe, Lord Jesus, was your blood shed on the cross for this
for our sins, Father, for the blood, that blood was shed for this country, I believe. Father God, you heard the rest of the prayer requests, Lord, just different in nature. Father God, it may be different in nature, but it's not different in God. Lord, you're the answer for all of our prayers. And Father God, we thank you for who you are. Lord, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your love. And we thank you for your mercy. Father God, I can't help but think about maybe there's a person in this church or somebody in media land, Lord, that's watching the sermon that, Father God, that they might be lost. They don't know what's missing. They just know something is missing in their life. Father, I pray that they not leave this church. Father God, they may not get up from their living room, Lord, or turn this the broadcast off before they might ask Christ to come into their heart and feel that emptiness that they have. And it's in his precious, precious name that we pray. Amen. Okay. Ute's going back. All right. Title of today's message is God's Blessing. God's Blessing. And I said just single, not plural, just blessing. as in an action. It's in action. He is blessing. He is in the process of being, we're in the process of being blessed. Of God's blessing us. now when I say God's blessing, guys, I'm not talking about like that group you see sometimes, you know, you hear about. Maybe you've been to those churches I've been, me and my wife have been. You know, they tell you just reach out and grab it. Just grab your blessing. Snatch it and grab it. Name it and claim it. Y'all know what I'm talking about. That's, guys, that's shallow. And it's almost shameful, if it's not downright shameful. It's and it, to be honest with you guys, it's adding and taking away from God's word. It really is. It's something like that. Where we take the word of God and we turn it into something like an equation or maybe a get rich quick scheme type thing, and we take verses out of God's word and apply them somewhere where they do not belong, and we take them completely out of context in order to support these things. And in so doing, then we are taking away from his word, because you're taking them away from the scripture and you're applying to them to your own, where you want what you want them to say instead of what they actually do say. Y'all pardon me just for a minute. Apologize for that. I think I better put one of these things in my mouth. R-A-T-T, rat now. But I'm not talking about that kind of blessing. I'm talking about a kind of blessing that, to be honest with you guys, it's just grace. That's what it is. That's the grace. That's the source of God's blessing to us, is his grace. Giving us something we don't deserve by any means. But because of his mercy, he holds back what we do deserve. And by his grace, he gives us what we don't deserve. And that's the source of the blessing that I'm speaking about here today. Amen. In Galatians chapter 3, Paul has a lot to say about this type of blessing that I'm speaking of here today. The book of Galatians, the reason Paul wrote that, it's known by some people, it's known as the Magna Carta of the New Testament. And the reason why is because in Galatia, the Gentile Christians were far outnumbered by Jewish Christians, those that were coming into faith. And those Jews held on to the law, a lot of what the law said. And when these new Gentiles were coming into faith, then they were putting all kinds of stuff on them. You know, Jesus tells us to come to me, who are weary and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. He says, because my yoke is easy and my burden is light. But what they were doing, I mean, they were coming to Jesus and getting unloaded
I mean, they've been going through this, through the life, you know, I've got to keep up with this law type stuff. And they get to that point where Christ says, you know what, you don't have to do this anymore because of what I did on the cross for you. I am extending to you God's grace to cover all of that so that we can have a relationship with Him. And these Jews were coming to, they're saying, no, you've got to be circumcised in order to be into the family. They were just, it's salvation plus, is what they were telling. And God, so Apostle Paul wrote the book, this letter to the Church of Galatia to confront that type of thing. So it's known as the Magna Carta of the New Testament because of that. It's because, you know, we had people needed to know that they were free and they had rights. They had certain rights. Did you know, guys, that it's actually very possible to please, possible to completely be at peace with God and still have the sin all around us and in us? Did you know that? It's through the grace that I'm speaking about. That's how we can have peace with Him. See, because when we come to, and we do that, don't we do that same thing as those Jews were doing to folk? Don't we do that today? Of course we do. Jesus is freeing us from all of this bondage that we have. And then we look at each other like, you know, I'm free from this thing right here. You can't be doing this and that. This is against the, you know, it's just not right. In the name of God, it's not right. And we're putting all this stuff back on them. Amen? See what I'm saying? We do that same thing. Excuse me, I'm sorry. I probably will be doing that throughout the service, and I am. I do apologize for that. I know it's going through this microphone, it sounds pretty raunchy, I'm sure. But we can please God. Isn't that nice to know that we can please God? And it's not based on our performance. But we can, we can still be passionate about serving God, even though we are not perfect. Amen? Isn't that nice to know? I think God wants us to know that here today. Because He's the one that takes all this burden off of us so that we can have a relationship with Him. You know, how many of us that have kids are perfect? Ain't any of us ever had kids that are perfect. I'll just answer that for you. Far from it, amen? But don't we just still love our kids? And in it like this, guys, if our kids did some stupid, and they do. I mean, some downright just stupid things, mean sometimes. Do we love them any less? Absolutely not. Now, when they do, it's really, 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 really good. Do we love them more? No. We're proud of them. And we're not proud of them sometimes. But we still love them the same, don't we? We can't love them any more than we do. God is the same way with us. He cannot love us any more than He does. And He cannot love us any less than He does. It's a perfect love for us. Amen? I'm spending a lot of time setting this thing up. I need to move on. But God wants us to know that. He wants us to know that, that we can glorify Him in the midst of us, our imperfections. And that's what it's all about, right? It's bringing glory to God. That's what we exist for. So when we're bringing glory to God, that's when we're at peace with God more than any other time. Amen? But He wants us to glorify Him by our gladness in Him because of His grace to us. Let me say that again. I know it's a little bit... God wants us to glorify Him, because that's the key, like I said, by our gladness in Him because of His grace to us. And that's the purpose of Galatians chapter 3. Like I said, it's the Magna Carta of the New Testament. I'm going to speak about three different... three topics here today, three points that I want to make here today. And it all has to do with the is that God's blessing comes through faith in Christ. That's the thing for all these 3 points that I'm going to make. The first one is going to be in the verses 6-9. That's this one. So if you do have your Bibles open, or you can see them right up here on the screen, that's going to be in Galatians chapter 3, beginning in verse 6. And I'm just going to read these 3 points, because this first point is that God's blessing always comes. Pardon me. He always comes through faith in Christ. But it always comes through faith in Christ. Verse 6. Consider Abraham. He believed God, and it was accredited to him as righteousness. Understand then that those who believe are children of Abraham. The scripture foresaw that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, and announced the gospel in advance to Abraham. All nations will be blessed, and that is a quote from Genesis chapter 12, verse 3. All nations will be blessed through you. So those who have faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith. This passage, guys, I mean, if you'll notice, Paul goes directly, right back to the book of Genesis. I mean, he goes all the way back to the beginning, and to Abraham, where the promise was made. And he quotes, several times, he quotes and refers to Genesis all through this passage. He uses Abraham to tell us how God's blessing is received. God's blessing is a central theme in Scripture. In the beginning, God created the world, and He blessed it. He blessed it. Now, that doesn't mean, guys, that God just said, "Well, I created everything. Now y'all be blessed." That's not what that means. Have y'all ever heard the theory about people who think that God created everything in the beginning, and he just wound up like a cosmic clock, and that thing just has to tick down? You ever heard that theory?
Yeah.
I've heard that theory. And it's like everything just happening out of his control. He just lets it go until the end. That's not God's blessing. That is not God's blessing. When God blesses something, then he empowers that blessing for his purpose. That something for his purpose. Amen?
Amen.
God promised Abraham a family that would outnumber the stars. And remember also he said that they would be so numerous that they would be more numerous than the sand, grains of sand on the seashore. Now that's a lot. Guys, if you added all of the Israelite race throughout time, I probably didn't come up to that. But if you add in the Gentiles, all of us being adopted into Abraham, into the family, then we're probably getting pretty close. Because we are, as the Bible said right there, as Paul said, that we are of that lineage. We are adopted into the promise of Abraham, all right? But like I said, I was saying that this is a central theme in Scripture. He also gave Abraham, he promised him a land to call his own, and a blessing that would empower him for life. And the story of the Bible is the development of that story, of that promise. Did you know that? That story, that right there, when God made that promise to Abraham, that's, you can just read all through the Old Testament. And it's all about that promise to the Israelites. Think about it. The nation began through him, through his lineage. I mean, he had Isaac, and Isaac had Jacob, and Jacob, his name was changed to Israel, and he was the father of, through all of his sons, the 12 tribes of Israel began. That's all in the Word. And it's all central. The scripture is centered around that promise to God, to Abraham, all the way through the Old Testament. But it's completely fulfilled through Christ. Amen? Story hadn't stopped. That promise hadn't stopped. God made a promise. He always keeps a promise. It's still going. It's still going right now through the Gentiles, which is us. All the adopted into his family. It's still going. It's going strong. So, Scripture is centered around that very truth about the promises of Abraham. God's blessing always has always been received by faith. Faith or believing or believe appears several times in verses 6 through 9. I'm going to read those again and point them out. Beginning in verse 6, consider Abraham. He believed, and it was accredited to him as righteousness. Understand then that those who believe are children of Abraham. It says believe but have faith. That we believe in Christ Jesus. We become a believer in Christ. Amen? Right? The scripture foresaw that God would justify the Gentiles by faith and announce the gospel in advance to Abraham. All nations will be blessed through him. So then, you had faith in the man, in faith. By faith, we are blessed along with Abraham, the father, the man of faith, the man of faith. So it's, look at how many times he mentioned right here in these first verses 6 through 9, the word faith or belief. Abraham's misdeeds didn't exclude him from God's blessing. His good deeds didn't earn him God's blessing. You know, that's where the kind of a rub is right there, guys, on this new prosperity doctrine and things of that nature. Is somehow we think that if we cross this I, dot this T, we do this little thing over here, like they tell us we need to do, like if we want to invest in something. We need to owe so much money, then we need to donate or whatever. We need to sow that seed into the ministry in order for that to happen. Those things, guys, they're get back to my point here. We think that we're going to be blessed that way because we do the right thing. Because, guys, here's the truth. The truth is that you do the right thing because it's the right thing to do. You don't get blessed by God because you do the right thing. You're blessed by God through his faith. But he's not going to give you a catch 22 in there where you can twist his word out of context and make it say something it doesn't. See what I'm saying? And God still works that way today. Like I said earlier, God can't love us any more than he does, and he can't love us any less than he does. And his blessings have always come through faith. Look at verses 10 through 12. God's blessing only comes through faith in Christ. Verse 10 through 12, let's just read that and I'll come back and preach on that. All who rely All who rely on observing the law are under a curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone who does not continue to do everything written in the book of the law. And that is a quote from Deuteronomy chapter 27, verse 26. Clearly, no one is justified before God by the law, because the righteous will live by faith. And that is a quote from Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4. It says the law is not based on faith. On the contrary, the man who does these things will live by them. So he's speaking about the when he says that the law is not based on faith, it's not. The law is not based on faith, but grace is based on faith. See, we're not under the law anymore. But like those Jews who were trying to put themselves back in the law or keep the law on them, then they're judged by that. See, because you're under a curse. Why are you under a curse if you're following the law, if you're under the law? You're under a curse because you're not going to receive salvation through Christ. You're going by the law. And the law is not was not created to get us salvation or right standing with God. It was there God gave us the law to show us how much we need Him. Because there's none of us that can live up to the law. Amen? So the law's there to show us that we need Jesus. We need a Christ to save us. Because we can't live up to the law. But it says that we're cursed. Verse 10 really says it, gets right to the point. Verse 10 says, all who rely on observing the law and are under a curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone who does not continue to do everything written in the book of the law. And if you're under that law, guys, you can't. There's no way that you can do everything that law says. Because we're so imperfect. So that makes us under a curse. Because we can't obey the law perfectly, right? So God's blessing can't come from works. Working at keeping a law only leads to a curse. And when it says the word, when I say works, I'm not talking about good works. Good works are a result of salvation. If we're saved and we're going to, then we're saved unto good works. We're going to do that. No, the works that are speaking of here, I believe, is this the works of at keeping. We work at keeping the law. We work at keeping the law. And like I said, guys, we can't keep the law. There's no way we can. There's no way we can. But God's blessing can only come by God's grace through faith. And that's the truth. Think about it like this. It only comes through faith. God's blessing only comes through faith. And that truth is humbling, is it not? It's humbling. Ephesians 2, 8 through 9 says this. Apostle Paul wrote it as well. For it is by grace that you have been saved through faith. And this not from yourselves. It is a gift of God. Not by works, so that no one can boast. No one should be able to look down at others. Because we're all in this together. All of us need the same thing. All of us need the same thing. In fact, James 1:9-10 says this, the brother in humble circumstances ought to take pride in his high position. But the one who is rich should take pride in his low position. If we look at one another, guys, if we look down on another believer, then we're standing in judgment of them. We're in judgment. Because all of us need grace from God. Every one of us. That's the reason I wanted to read that to James. It don't matter what, if you've got very little, if you got nothing, you're still rich in God. And if you got way, I mean, you're rich, rich, rich. Then you need to be humble. You need to be. You still need that same God. Those riches aren't going to get you into heaven. All of us need that same thing. I like to look at it like this: at the foot of the cross is ground zero. All of us come to. There's no Jew or slave or male or female or
Gentile, it doesn't make any difference. We all come to that cross with the same thing, nothing. With a need for everything. Amen? So we shouldn't look at it, we should not look down at one another. But we should be humble. Because that truth, this truth is a very, is humble. We are in need of saving grace that only comes through faith in Christ. Not only is that truth humbling, but it is also liberating. A couple of pages, maybe one page over, Apostle Paul says this in chapter 5, verse 13. For you have been called to live in freedom, my brothers and sisters. So, God's grace is liberating us. Think about it, God. We're trapped in our trespasses and sins. We're a slave to the world. Maybe we don't realize that. But God, through Christ, liberates us from those things. It's very liberating. Look at verses 13 to 14. God's blessing richly comes through faith in Christ. Verse 13, it starts out by showing us how Christ rescues us. Look at verse 13. Christ redeemed us. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. He paid that price. For it is written, and this is from Deuteronomy chapter 21, verse 23, as it is written, cursed is everyone who is hung on a tree. He redeemed us in order that the blessing given Abraham might come to the Gentiles through Christ Jesus, so that by faith we might receive the promise of the Spirit. Or I said the Holy Spirit because it's capitalized. It means the Holy Spirit. So that we can receive the promise of the Holy Spirit. I just thought about this, but you know the greatest promised land is what? Is it getting some land right here on this earth? Yeah. No, man, that was just a forethought. I mean, just giving us a picture of just a snapshot of what the promised land really is. You can read about the New Jerusalem, which is the promised land, so to speak, when God brings it down, the new heaven and the new earth, and He brings down the city of Jerusalem, comes down, this new Jerusalem. And that is the promised land, of course, when we get into heaven. I know it's kind of, shouldn't even have to say that, right, Doug? Of course. We were redeemed from the curse. But here's the deal too, guys. We're redeemed from the curse, but we are redeemed for good works for God. So we're redeemed from, but we're redeemed for as well. Amen? And the ultimate blessing. Oh, I'm sorry. Let me say this. What does it say in verse 14? It says that he redeemed us in order that the blessing given to Abraham might come to the Gentiles through Christ Jesus, so that by faith we might receive the promise of the Holy Spirit. So we're redeemed so that we can receive God's Spirit. That's the reason we're redeemed. Amen? Y'all don't think that's cool?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Right. But the ultimate blessing is God living in us in grace. The promise of the Holy Spirit means that we can practice the presence of Christ. And the reason I say that is because, guys, in the Old Testament, you had God with man. He was with man. He was not seen by man, but he was with man.
and people could know the word of the mind of God and the purpose of God only through His written word and the prophets who revealed His word to you. Just think about it. You didn't. That's only two ways you know. But at the day of Pentecost, when Christ came and dwelt, when the Holy Spirit came down and dwelled within man, not with him in man, we have the presence of Christ, and we can live in that presence. And through Him, we have the mind of God. We can know that through our spirit. We're rich. We're richly blessed by God. I'm going to wrap this thing up. Brian's going to come up here. I'm going to wrap this thing up, guys. I'm just going to just recap just for a second. And that's by saying that God's blessing always comes through faith in Christ. His blessing only comes through faith in Christ. And His blessing is richly, it richly comes through the faith, our faith in Christ. I'm going to ask you a couple questions here, guys. Let me ask you something. Where is what is the source of your strength? What is the source of your strength? Source of my strength is Christ. I can do all these things through Christ. It gives me strength. All the trials of the world, everything that I have to go through, I'm going through it by, according to His purpose. He gives me strength to get through it. He is my portion. He's your portion. Do you know today that you are blessed by God through faith in Christ? Do you know that? Because let me tell you something, God. When I realized that, that was life-changing to me. It was. I can remember a moment when God just, He touched me in such a way that, guys, I just began to bawl. I cried. I was a grown man. There was just blubbering. Because I felt the presence of God. This is life changing when He moves in our lives. Amen. The only way that we can partake in this blessing that I'm speaking of, this God's blessing, which is grace, the manifold of God's, all of His blessing is the grace. Through the Holy Spirit. Actually, the manifold is the Holy Spirit. But His blessing is grace. It's always found in grace. Amen. Not a get-rich scheme. Have you made a profession of faith? Are you a believer? I'd like to give you an opportunity now. If maybe you've been going through your life here as of late, and God is just you can't turn to the right or left without someone talking about God, or maybe just realizing that He is real and He wants to have a relationship with you. Maybe you're to that point in your life. I mean, has He been dealing with you like that as of late? Is He showing you that you have an emptiness in your heart that needs to be filled? See, that's God drawing us to Him. The Bible makes it clear that we will never come to God. But He comes to us. He draws us to Himself. Amen. And that faith that I mentioned before, guys, we have faith all day long in things. But the faith to believe in God is given by God. It's a gift from Him.
He gives us a measure of faith. And that process of him tilling up the soil of our heart, getting it ready for the seed of salvation. That's how God operates in us, and he's letting us, he's getting us ready, guys, and he's ready to make a move. See, today is the day of salvation. That's what the Bible says. Not tomorrow. You're not promised. You don't know what a day will bring. You can leave this church now. You can get up from your living room after watching this broadcast right now. You can go out to the store, and it could be the end of your life. Your day could be, I mean, once it's appointed once for a man to die, then the judgment, the Bible says. If you'd like to ask Christ into your heart, you can do it right where you're sitting. The altar's open for anyone who has a prayer need. Don't leave here with something you came in here with. Bring God glory by bringing it up to the altar and allowing us to the blessing of praying with you, going through your to just be part of your suffering. Amen. And it brings glory to God. But if you don't ask Christ into your heart, you can do it right where you're sitting. Every head bowed, every eye closed. God's tugging on your heart. It's time to answer his call. You can say that with a simple prayer like this, and just mean it from your heart. Just repeat after me if you are lost. First thing you have to do is just admit to him, Lord, I'm a sinner. Right now, Lord, I turn from that sin. I agree, Lord, that you are right and I am wrong. And I want to do things your way. So, Jesus, I'm asking you to come into my heart now. I receive you by faith into my spirit. I believe you died on that cross for my sin. You rose back to life. You're living in me now. Recognize you as my God, my Lord, and my friend. From this moment forward, I will serve only you. Jesus, precious, precious name. Amen. Said that prayer for the first time. Come see me right after services. If you're watching on Facebook or YouTube, you can see my contact information right there on my telephone. 972-872-5132. Call me up. Talk to me. That's the most important decision you'll ever make in your life, and I need to talk to you about it. Amen. Let's pray one last time. We'll get on out of here. Father, we love you so, so very much. Father God, may we not just get caught up in the world, and Father God, maybe just led astray by every whim, just every little thing that comes our way, Father God, that Father God, that we would hear you, Lord. Hear that small, still voice, Lord, just speaking to us in our spirit. Father God, when things are wrong, show us that they are. Father God, we know we must be doers of your word, not hearers only. Father, just especially the way the country is going right now, Father God, and not just the country, but the world. We must be your light, be your salvation, and be your bring your salvation, and Lord, just be salt to this earth, a preservative, and just make things taste better. So, Father, just show, like I said, show us how to be doers of your word, not hearers only, so that we can take these things we're learning into a lost and dying world. Father God, till we get back up here Thursday night or next Sunday, Lord, we just ask for your perfect speed and your favor. We ask this in Jesus' precious, precious name. Amen. All right, guys, we love you. See you next week.